Elliott. Help you home?
Imagine you're home. Where the hell is she gonna be, huh? Imagine you're hiding from your big brother treat. Philip? Philip! Philip? Philip, I ain't in the mood for no hide and go seek game. Philip, you hear me? Come the fuck out!
Tag me.
I'm gonna tag you.
Because I'm sick and tired of being it.
I'm gonna tag you. I told you I'm playing no games.
You promise?
I promise. How long have you been hiding?
I don't know.
Half the day, I bet.
I keep count.
You have lunch?
Uh-huh.
What'd you have?
Turkish tuna.
Mayonnaise?
Uh-huh, helmets.
How much mayonnaise you have?
Tablespoons.
Huh. You only had a couple tablespoons out, and we're all out of it.
Helmets goes fast, right?
It goes fast, all right. Half a bottle a day. Hey. You're it.
No!
You're fucking it!
Promise!
I have my fingers crossed.
I come out because you said you wouldn't.
Time out!
No!
Fucking time out, Philip! Game's over. Where were you?
I'm telling.
Come on.
No, it's my secret.
I know where you were anyway.
Where?
In the closet.
Now you know that.
It's your favorite hiding place.
I was hiding there waiting for you to come home.
Just standing, waiting.
Uh-huh.
Just hiding and waiting for your big brother treat to come home.
I like in there, it's warm.
I wouldn't know.
It's got all mom's coats in there.
Oh, I gotta get rid of those.
No!
What good are they doing hanging there all these years?
I want them!
They're not doing anybody any good.
They're not bothering anybody, treat, they're just hanging there!
Look, Philip, people find out about you. They're gonna put you away.
They won't put me away!
Grown man standing all day in a closet?
I did other things.
What are the things you do?
I looked out the window.
Oh, good.
I seen some things.
What did you see?
I seen a man with a dog. Man walking a big black dog.
Woof. Woof. What else?
Oh, I seen a teeny tiny woman.
Anything else?
Plenty else.
Go on.
I seen a man with two big boys, man in the middle, boy on each side.
What were they doing?
Going swimming, maybe? Going to the movies, probably. Gonna see John Wayne in the halls of Montezuma.
You got an imagination.
I seen other things. I seen a man with a woman. A man walking arm in arm with a woman. Woman had long, long red hair.
Wait, woman had long red hair? Was a man balding?
Man was balding, right.
Woman had bangles dangling from her wrist, am I right?
That's right, Tree.
I've seen that couple. What else you do?
I watch TV.
What'd you watch?
I watched reruns. I watched The Price is Right.
That's a woman's show.
Hey, that fabulous prizes.
Oh, I bet you'd like to win one.
They won a high bi-serial combination, a year's supply of LPs and cassettes. They won a mahogany dining room set. They won an Electrolux golf cart and Bendix freezer filled with 500 filet mignon.
You remember all that?
They won a year's subscription to National Geographic. They won
That's enough.
I'd like to get that National Geographic tree.
What would you do with it?
Look at it.
You'd read it?
I can't read, tree. But look at the pictures, though. They got real nice pictures. Pictures of all kinds of animals and primitive tribes.
Ran into that woman and man today. Man was balding. Woman had long red hair.
That's right.
I had a real good day today, Phil. I want to go out tonight. Gonna celebrate.
We all had a man named Tree. You go home. We go out tonight. We bring home an extra large bottle.
Siri had a hell of a day today, Philip. You interested?
I'm interested, Tree. I just got a real taste in my mouth for that Hellman's.
My man wasn't carrying much. Only had a couple bucks. But he had a real nice wristwatch. What do you think?
That's nice.
Man had good taste. When did that bad taste either? Look at this.
Tiny little wrist. Tiny little dainty little wrist. For this.
No more. Ran into another fellow earlier today, Fairmount Park. Fellow put up a struggle.
No kidding.
I said, look, mister, what are you getting violent about? There's no need to get violent.
Well, what did he do?
He kicked at me.
He kicked you?
Right in the shin. It's gonna fucking black and blue.
Look at the hydrogen peroxide.
You remember all them brand names?
Uh-huh.
How come you could do that?
I don't know.
I mean, you don't have much an intellect for anything else, but remember all them brand names and names of them various prizes.
It just comes to me.
I said, look, mister, I don't appreciate getting kicked in the shins like that. Hey.
What'd he say?
He cursed at me.
He cursed you?
Oh, all kinds of names. Names I wouldn't even repeat. Terrible fucking filth came out of that man's mouth.
What did he look like?
It's just real nice. I had on a suit and tie. Must have driven into Fairmount Park. It's a real nice spring day today, Philip. Too bad you couldn't go and enjoy it. Philip figured he'd take a walk in Fairmount Park.
What happened?
He had a lot of money on him. That's why he put up a struggle. Must have had $300-$400.
Where is he?
Left him there. Had to cut him though. Not bad. Not bad. Just superficial. I warned him though. In fact, I said, look, mister, you're getting me pissed off. Kicking me in the shins like that.
Did you show him the bruise?
I didn't have to show him the bruise. He got me pissed off. I had to take out my knife. I had to cut him.
Did he bleed?
Only a little bit, Philip. But you know, it's amazing how people just, they stop struggling once there's a little bit of blood. Paper cum?
Uh-huh.
Let's have it.
I'm early this morning.
What's this?
What's what?
How come this word is underlined?
I don't know.
How come there are underlined words in this here Philadelphia Inquirer?
I have no idea, Tree.
Here's a word. Dispensation. What's this word mean?
I don't know, Tree.
You underline this word?
I didn't touch that word.
You read this word?
No.
You got a dictionary, Philip?
I got no dictionary.
You sure ain't got no pocket dictionary? You sure ain't reading, spending the day reading, looking up meanings of particular words, getting yourself an education?
I got no education.
You know the alphabet, Philip?
Oh.
I bet you know the fucking alphabet. I bet you're holding out on me.
I'm not holding out on you.
Who underlined this fucking... Dispensation.
It wasn't me.
Someone was in the house while I was away?
I don't know.
You would have heard.
I was in the closet.
Someone come in the house, stealing in my house. Well, you were in the closet, underlying this word?
Maybe.
Where is he?
I don't know.
Is he still here?
He might be.
Find him.
Alright.
Kill him. You understand? Man stealing in my house like that?
Maybe he's upstairs.
Yeah, maybe.
Maybe he's hiding under the bed.
I wouldn't put him past him. Hiding under the bed, waiting for us to go to sleep.
Yeah, I'll find him. I was looking under the bed, he came out of the closet.
Oh. That's not bad. It's just a little scratch.
I jumped back and banged into the night table. The lamp fell over.
I heard
it. Oh, if I hadn't jumped back, she would have stabbed me right through the back. Oh, no.
Lucky for you. Where is he?
He got him. He leaped out the window.
He got away?
Uh-huh.
What'd he look like?
Errol Flynn. The movie actor.
I know Errol Flynn.
He could have broken a leg leaping out of the window like that. He must be some kind of athlete. Oh!
I should get some hydrogen peroxide.
No! Treat it burns!
You don't want it to get infected.
He's not gonna get infected.
You don't want to lose your arm.
I'm not gonna lose my arm.
Come on, Philip. Let me help you. Let your big brother take care of you. I thought you incorporated the notes very, very nicely.
Thank you.
You made some nice changes. In particular, the main one about not pushing it past the point of it being so abusive to him that the audience wouldn't understand why you would stay in the relationship. Mm-hmm. The thing that you guys achieved today, which was really nice, was that you showed the symbiotic nature of their relationship, yeah. Of the brother, the older younger brother relationship, and I thought that worked really, really nicely today. The discovery of the underlying word, and the lie that was being perpetrated today. It was really, really clear to me that we've sung this song before. Uh-huh. That this has happened before. That there's been enough evidence over the years of the fact that words are underlined, that things are happening that could not happen if he were truly illiterate. But you guys did the dance. You did the dance really, really nicely, and you played the clown enough for him to let it slide yet again. Mm-hmm. Later on in the play, once Harold's influence becomes powerful over you, that's when he can't look the other way anymore, and that's when he finds all the books with all the underlined words, and he pushes them in your face, and that's when it does get abusive. Which is one of the reasons why I wanted you to be careful
because otherwise you're playing the end of the scene at the beginning of the scene. If he's beating him and throwing him against the wall in the first act, then you have no place to go to in the second act. It progressively gets worse. As Harold's influence over the two of you, and in particularly Philip, as his influence over you becomes stronger, Treat's influence over you wanes, and then you start standing up for yourself. And once he starts standing up for himself, then you do start to get physically abusive, and it builds to this climax. So I didn't want to lose the sense of that in the very first scene of the play. The world that you guys created, doesn't it feel like just a kid's fort? Mm-hmm. You know, when you take the blankets and you move the furniture together and you drape it over, and if it were like the Thanksgiving Day weekend or the weekend between Christmas and New Year's, your parents would let you leave it up for a little bit. And if they let you leave it up, then you'd start bringing stuff into it. You'd start to bring
way too much fun with this.
Yeah,
this was way too fun for me.
Well, I mean, it's the ultimate man cave built by boys who have no restrictions on them.
It's like the upgrades in the Fight Club house.
Yeah, yeah. Well, this is
where
the
fun. That's what I like envision.
Exactly. When there's, I mean, I there was zero evidence of a woman's touch anywhere to be seen. This is what happens when you let men raise themselves. They turn into like savages. I mean, it's kind of like, you know, it's kind of like Lord of the Flies.
Yeah.
The savage instinct in boys, if it's not checked, leads to murder in Lord of the Flies.
Yeah.
In this, it gets pretty serious as well. But I felt like you guys really incorporated the notes. You made some wonderful changes. The back and forth with the dialogue, there was no sense that you were reading the lines off of the back of your eyelids anymore. And the movement around the room, it just feels like we've done this dance before. You know what I mean? I mean, how many times has he chased them around the room? How many times has he had to do the pantomime of somebody breaking into the house? And your face while he's in the other room, because he's just sitting there, you know, listening to you like, all right, this will be over soon. But you really have to sell it. You have to play the clown. I loved it when you play it when you started picking the stuff out of his. I think that's when you were talking about National Geographic.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was great. That was great. The only thing I missed was my tightrope.
Ah, yeah.
Yeah, I missed you walking the tightrope this time. But the other physical stuff, the tiger roll and the movement around the room, the becoming all the characters that you were playing. It's a wonderful moment with the red blanket and the woman with the red hair.
Mm-hmm. I thought that was genius.
That was wonderful.
I saw him do that, I'm like, you.
That was, what, did you do that in the moment?
Yeah, I just thought, red hair, red blanket, I'm just gonna take it and put it in my head.
That was a very Philip thing to do. And he has become a master at pantomime and a master at clowning. Founding and becoming his entertainment, and I love the hug at the end. See, if you had been as vicious as you were last week, then we would have never earned that hug because you would have never gotten to him. And the stick to him was great, but eventually it comes down, and then there's your need to take care of him, the vulnerability in your voice when you said, "Come on, Philip. Let your big brother Treat take care of you." It's basically saying, I need to hug you now. I need to be able to give this gift to you, because the real gift is you hugging me back. Because that's why I do everything I do. Yeah. Everything I do, speaking as Treat, is for the benefit of providing for you and making sure that you feel appreciated. There's a real need in Treat to feel appreciated, and he shows you that he appreciates what you do, going out there and risking your neck every day mugging people, so that he can be safe and he can have his Hellman's mayonnaise and he can not have to face the world with his with this infection that you told him, this allergy that you told him that if he ever went outside again, he would die. So it's a dance that keeps on getting played again and again and again and again. And you know, now I feel like you guys understand where the play starts, so you can go on to the second scene. You know what I'm saying? How many people have seen this before?
They've seen this scene.
This with these guys. So you see you can see the metamorphosis of when they first started to where they are today. Yeah.
Yeah.
Let me ask you a question. Do you have empathy for both of them or just one of them?
Both, 100%.
Everyone says both?
Yeah,
both. Okay, last week, did you have empathy for both of them?
No.
No. That's where I wanted you to go. I wanted that question to be answered in the affirmative, because if there's empathy for Treat, even though he's going out there and he's doing these things, and even though he's kind of rough with his brother, if there's empathy for him at the end of the first scene, and even at the end of the whole play, then you're answering what the playwright has put down on the page, because we have to care about you guys. This is a heartbreaking, story, and it's red meat for actors. I mean, you know, Harold comes in and he's, you know, a guy about my age, and he changed, you know, he becomes the father figure and changes everything up. And when, you know, at the beginning of the second act, the lights come up and the apartment, the house is immaculate. And Treat comes in and he's wearing a suit.
Mm-hmm.
And Philip comes in and he's wearing, you know, khakis and a cardigan and a bow tie, and his hair is all fixed and he's reading a book. And, you know, it's, you have to start here, so we can see the whole arc to get to the other side. And today, you started in the place you needed to start in, so that by the end of the play, you will have traveled the distance. So, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Good. All right. Great. Well done.